Okay, here are the four things that we're gonna look for. We're gonna look for genre, we're gonna look for words, we're gonna look for grammar, and we're gonna look for atmosphere. Let me explain them briefly to you and then we'll try it together. Genre is the literary form. There are different forms of literature and we read them differently. We observe differently in different genres of literature. The Bible has a whole bunch of genres, examples. There's Hebrew poetry in the Bible. The Psalms and the Proverbs are examples. Job, portions of Job are examples too. But even the Psalms and Proverbs are different kinds of Hebrew poetry. In the Psalms, it's basically lyrics for songs. In Proverbs, it's what's called parallelism. They're parallel couplets that teach wisdom. Totally different kinds of poetry, different genres of poetry. We have letters in the New Testament, right? We have personal letters, 3 John, 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy. We have letters to churches. So we have 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians. We have Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians. We have some letters that read like legal briefs, right? Romans looks like a legal brief, all different genres of letters. We have just amazing narrative, expansive narrative. We have Genesis and Exodus. We have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And the four gospels are narrative, but they're also biographies. So there's different genre there. Within the gospels, we have another little genre. It's called a parable. And you read parables differently than you read historical narrative. That's another genre, narrative that's history. You have 1 and 2 Samuel and 1 and 2 Kings and 1 and 2 Chronicles and Acts. It's history. You read that differently than you read poetry. We have allegory. We have a love song. The Song of Solomon is, it's a love song. Make Frank Sinatra blush. We have apocalyptic prophecy. You read that differently than you read letters to Ephesians. We even have satire in the Bible. You know what satire is? It's the use of humor to kind of expose and criticize something that's wrong in the world. Satire can be extremely funny. It can be a little biting too. If you don't know it's satire, you can get offended. So I follow this guy on Twitter. His name is Lloyd Legalist. He's a satirical Twitter guy. And what he does is he pokes fun at the church. He pokes fun at you and me and our legalism. And as you read it, it smacks a little bit and it's funny too. You find yourself laughing. What's really hilarious is reading the comments under some of his satire, because some people obviously don't realize it's satire. And so in quite sanctimonious language, they call old Lloyd Legalist out. And then someone has to tell them, buddy, it's satire. Satire is the use of humor. Oh, never mind. If you don't realize it's satire, you're gonna misinterpret it. You have to know what kind of genre you're dealing with so you know how to observe. That's the first thing. The second thing we're gonna look for is words. Keywords, obvious words. Just start with the obvious. Kay Arthur, in her book on how to read the Bible, she says, when you start observing words, just look for the obvious ones. It's like doing a jigsaw puzzle. How do you start a jigsaw puzzle? What do you start with? You start with the corners, right? Because there's only 4 of them and they're different from all the rest. They've got 2 straight sides, right? And so they're easy to find. They're the most obvious ones. Then what do you do? The straight edges, the edges, right? Because there's less of those and they're easier to find. And once you got the corners and the edges in place, then you can start filling in the middle. Now, and what Kay says is, yeah, you can get really deep into your observation, but just start with the most obvious words, the words that jump off the page, the words that look like they mean something important, and then just start asking questions about them. Try to figure out what they mean and why the author used them. Grammar. Grammar! You remember grammar? Back in 5th grade, you swore you'd never do it again. But here's the problem. Grammar is one of the places where you will find the most beautiful nuggets in God's word. The grammar matters. I'll give you a couple examples today. We don't have time to get into too much of the grammar, but we'll look at 2 things. We'll look at proper nouns, names of people and places, and we'll look at verbs. And with verbs, we'll look at 2 things. We'll look at the tense. The tense is simply, is it past, is it present, or is it future? Now, in Greek, there's a number of different past tenses and there's a number of different future tenses. We're not going to get into all of that because this is, it's not Greek to me. You don't have to know Greek to understand the Bible. You can learn it just with your English Bible. And so we'll just look at tenses that you can see right in the English language. We have tense and we have mood. When we talk about mood, we're talking about whether it is an indicative or an imperative. This is the end of the grammar, okay? So just get this. Indicative is a statement of fact. An imperative is a command. Two different types of verbs. A statement of fact or a command. And when you're seeing the verbs, you need to ask yourself, is it past, present, or future? And is it a statement of fact or is it a command? And that will give you a glimpse into what the author is trying to communicate to you, okay? So that's the grammar we're gonna cover today. And then atmosphere is where you place yourself into the text. This is where imagination comes in. You place yourself into the text, you ask yourself, now, if there are characters in the text, which character would be me? And then you put yourself in that place and you allow your senses to receive it. You smell what it smells like. You see what everyone else is seeing. You hear what they're hearing. And you start to feel what they're feeling. And you enter into the text. Now, if you come to God's word, you open it up, and you pause and you say, Holy Spirit, I know that God's word is living and active. It's like a double-edged sword and it wants to deal with me. It wants to grow me. You want to grow me through this book. So I offer myself, Holy Spirit, speak to me, reveal your truth to me in this time. If you offer yourself to the Spirit, as you observe in these areas, will start to point things out to you. And it'll feel like he's speaking personally to you through the Bible.